So one of the very fun skills you typically gain as a healthcare human is the ability to identify illness by, just guess, the smell, the color, the sound. You get to use all your senses. How fun. Identifying diseases based on smell and phlegm color may not be the superpower that you always dreamed of, but it is the superpower that you have been given, and you should use it to the utmost of your ability. Unless, of course, this makes you want to vomit. In which case, here are a few different ways to help neutralize some of the truly gross things that you will see working in healthcare. Because gross smells kind of come with the territory. I'm gonna kill the lawnmower. I think it's my dad. No, it is my dad. Just kidding. I'm not gonna kill you. But if you could stop, that would be great. Thank you. Hello there. If you're new here, welcome. I'm Liz. I'm a family nurse practitioner, where honestly, I don't do nearly as many gross things as I used to do when I was a med surg nurse. So I have quite a bit of practice masking odors. In fact, I worked on a liver, GI, kidney type floor, which meant I got both GI difficulties mixed with like pressure sores, as well as a lot of gangrenous appendages. So really the best of all worlds. How wonderful. Let's begin. First, this is the most important thing I will say in this entire video, so please listen closely. Just because someone's body is creating an odor or a mucus that is difficult should in no way change the care that you give them, or it should not even cause you to outwardly make a face. It is literally your job to treat the humans that you interact with in a way that makes them feel valued and like the respected humans that they are. They are vulnerable. They are the vulnerable person here, not you. They probably know that they don't smell great. They don't need any reminder of everything that's going on that is disgusting. So while smells can be wildly powerful and challenging, know that the methods here can help, but they won't eliminate the smell. And you will need to be able to deal with that if you plan on working in a setting that will have smells or gross things. And if you are a human who cannot handle those things and you aren't willing, if you don't want to become used to them or work through it, then you need to choose your specialty accordingly. There are a lot of specialties that don't revolve around particularly gross things, but remember that your intolerance of rough smells or disgusting situations is not your patient's problem, and you are the one that needs to accommodate around that. Okay? All right. Here's why I get passionate about that. I have seen so many people walk into a room and go, oh gosh, and cover their mouth and run out, or grimace when they see a patient turn over and they see their sacral pressure wound, or shriek when sputum lands on them out of the trach as the patient is coughing, or saying something about a patient's incontinence. And the look on patients' faces, as you can imagine, when that happens, is devastating. Obviously, it's just sad. In case you couldn't tell, this is obviously something I feel pretty passionate about. So that's my soapbox. But let's discuss, now that we've kind of gotten that out of the way, how to actually deal with some of these gross situations, because you don't have to love them. By all means, you do not have to love them. You just need to learn how to cope with them. And here's some of the ways you can. First, our friend, the face mask. We have gotten wonderfully acquainted with the face mask, particularly in the last few years, and it doesn't block all odor, but it hides your face and does hide some odor. So if you are in any way worried that your face might make some interesting expressions, just go put on a face mask before you go in the room. Nobody, especially now during COVID, will question why you are wearing a mask. I will use me as an example. I do not do well with sputum or pus. I know this about myself. So whenever I do procedures that may in any way involve sputum or pus, I will wear a mask. If there was a pool of poo around a patient, I wore a mask. If I was going in to change a tunneling sacral pressure wound dressing, I was gonna wear a mask because I didn't want to accidentally have my face show anything other than compassion, and this is totally okay. Also, the mask allows you to put something under your nose, whatever you'd like. I usually put Vicks Vapor Rub under my nose because it had the staying power, like really stayed there. I kept some in one of those tiny little Vaseline things that you get at the dollar section of the store, like the tiny, tiny tubs, they're so cute. And I would rub it under my nose prior to potentially sticky situations. And if you don't have that, acquire some toothpaste from the clean room of your hospital or healthcare facility and put that underneath your nose. If you don't want to put it on your face, then put two masks on and just smear some of that stuff between the two masks. It's a little bit harder to like breathe, especially if you're using Vicks and it's like petroleum jelly, but you'll be okay. You can do that with literally any scent. Some people I know would put like a lavender essential oil on a mask that there was like, and that was their like stink mask. Just be careful with that you don't put a ton on. That can be really hard because some patients are sensitive to smells. Other people just had like Burt's Bees chapstick and they would put that on their upper lip under a mask because it had a minty smell to it and it was easy to use because it was in the tube, so application was easy. Whatever floats your boat, but having some kind of a scent that you could put right around your nose was an absolute lifesaver. My general rule with this was that I would wear a mask into any situation I thought could potentially be disgusting, and if I didn't need it, I could come back later with it off. Better safe than sorry. So I was more prone to like just mask up just in case rather than not. So that was how I primarily masked smells, like on myself, my own self-contained unit. The next tip I have for handling more gross situations is snacks. I found that those around me were infinitely more likely to feel ill, myself included, if we had not eaten recently. I personally found the best snacks were those pretzels with the peanut butter in the middle because it gave you some carb and some protein and you could stash them in one of your very many scrub pockets. I like to wear like nice and baggy scrubs and lay like 8 million pockets and I would just like have all sorts of things in all of my arsenal. Pop it in my mouth every like 30 minutes, just one cracker, to keep my body happy because goodness knows I was not going to be getting a lunch break, and just having something to eat helped so much since you never really knew when you were gonna eat, all of that. I remember I almost passed out when I was in my first C-section, like I really almost did, because I had blown off the whole like you should eat this morning before you go in warning, and wow, regrets. That's all I have to say. Also, if you've ever had a C-section, I have immense respect for you because that was a lot. And I've seen a lot of other surgeries and that was just a lot. Okay, now on to my favorite method, avoidance. I get asked a lot if you get used to things that really gross you out, because we all have that thing that really grosses us out, and I'm sure you wish the answer was of course, but instead it's kinda. However, there is a ton of different nursing jobs, so don't set yourself up for failure here, my friend. If you hate sputum, hi, that's me, don't work on a respiratory unit, and maybe avoid working in like a medical ICU where a lot of people will be trached for a very long time. If you hate poop, well, there was a lot of poop in nursing, but you can try to find a job with less of it. Find the place that is going to fit you the best. For example, I cannot do sputum. Like I said, I wear a mask every single time I interact with a human with a trach because I just cannot handle it. But the rest of the stuff doesn't bug me as much. So I worked in a surgical specialty with less boogers after I did med surg. We saw it sometimes, but it wasn't all the time. And even sometimes when I was working there and I had a baby or a kid with a trach, I would go to another nurse who hated things that I didn't mind, and we would switch. I'd be like, I'll do totally go in and clean up that poop disaster if you go in and do trach care on my kid. That's fine. Perfect. A nice trade. Does it work all the time? No. Sometimes I did have to do trach care, and sometimes nasty, horrible things came out of there. A mask, a little vapor rub, it all worked out okay. So please know that while you can try to control these things, sometimes you might have to see the things you really hate. You will have to see it in school. So you do have to get through that. You don't have a choice over that, but you do have a choice over where you work. So don't let the fear of barf consume you, and feel free to ask in interviews, like just honestly, like, do you have a lot of people, like, is, you know, what's, I don't know how to nicely say, like, do they poop a lot here? But you know what I mean? You can ask interview questions that will sort of lead you up to, you know, if you don't like blood, do you have a lot of surgical wounds here? Like, what are we dealing with here? Are a lot of people, do you have a lot of patients with pressure sores? That's gonna, like, you know, pus, all of that stuff. Asking those questions will give you a better idea. And then ask the nurses, because you should always talk to the nurses before you accept a job. And you can just ask them point blank, do people poop here a lot? And they'll tell you yes or no. Okay, so what if you have done all the things and you still feel like you are going to throw up? And this happens, and it is not a moral failing. A lot of things we do as nurses are really weird, and it is really okay for your body to be like, what are you witnessing? We are evolutionarily trained to get away from blood, unfavorable body fluids, and phlegm. So do not be too hard on yourself if you are struggling. As long as you are struggling, mostly silently, and internally, just bury all of those feelings. Everything you learned in psych, forget about it. And just know that you're normal. It's okay. We're just gonna have to try to mask this. But what does happen when your patient coughs something truly horrifying out of their trach and you gag? If it's safe to do so, just turn around real quick and always bring some alcohol wipes with you into a room. Remember, scrubs with a billion pockets, you'll have them with you at all times, and set them like somewhere on a surface nearby if you're doing something that could be gross. Rip one of the alcohol wipes open and sniff it. It helps more often than not and can be fairly inconspicuous. You know, you can just like turn around, take a breath and turn back, take a moment, regroup, and then get back to it. But turning your face away and smelling an alcohol wipe can really help you just regain your composure for a moment. The smell is very powerful, and sometimes it can just kind of even like wake you up and get you in the zone. Anyway, I'm not recommending huffing alcohol wipes. This is going in a weird direction. Anyway, finally, what about the rooms that are just stinky? Because guess what? Sometimes people are stinky when they are sick, and it is no fault of their own. Can bring in some coffee grounds. It works surprisingly well for so many different types of odors. One of the units I worked on had a cabinet. We kind of stored the patient's med inside their room, and you could leave the door like halfway open, and I would put coffee grounds in there in a little coffee filter, and it helps so much. Or you can just put them like in a cup in the filter or something and leave them out in the open. Wherever seems safe, like it's not gonna accidentally get knocked over, change it out like every day or so, and it absorbs a ton of the smell without giving off like too powerful of an odor. It's easy to leave in the area where it's not necessarily always obvious if you'd prefer the patient to not see it. But most of the time, the patient knows that their poop explosion like doesn't necessarily smell the best and doesn't mind at all, or doesn't even notice with the 8 billion cups in their room that you added one more. And last but not least, I might have said last time, but this is the real last. Try to take the trash out as frequently as you can, or put a blue pad on top of the trash can to contain the smell if it's harboring some interesting things inside of it. It can help keep it sometimes like hidden and damped down. So anything really helps here. And there you have it. I am excited to hear about your ways of handling the challenging sensations and smells. The whole experience that can come with this type of a job. And we would all be delighted if you have any other tips that you want to leave down below. You never know when you will be able to save someone from vomiting into a patient trash can after the patient vomits on your shoe. You might be able to save someone from that with your comment below. So please do. And if you ever need a free nursing report sheet or a soap note template or anything, I just added those as a free download that you can get. So make sure to sign up at the link below. They're free, and it will, yeah, you get those, and it adds you to like my mailing list, and then I'll email you like rarely, but about like relevant nursing things and free goodies and all the stuff as I continue to make them. So that is that. Good luck. You can do this. Don't let the gross smells keep you away. Just keep your everything hidden. Shove down those feelings. You'll be fine. All right. On that excellent note, I will see you next time. Best of luck. Bye.